Good evening. Welcome to the Monrovia City Council for Tuesday, July 2nd, 2013. This evening, we will have an invocation by our police chaplain, Terrence Brown, and Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Tom Adams.
Let us pray. Oh Lord, once again, we are gathered together for this purpose, to discuss and develop initiatives, plans, and strategies that will further enhance and build this great city, a city that you have truly blessed and graced with your presence and divine favor, a city of concerned residents that are proactive, opposed to reactive. Thank you for the mind that you've given each and every one of us to truly work together in the spirit of love, unity, and fellowship, understanding and embracing the idea that we are truly better together. Now on tonight, we request your blessing, wisdom, and counsel. Bless this meeting, its participants, and the agenda. Let the discussions be positive, the proposals productive, and the projects cost-effective and efficient. In your glorious name we pray, amen.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
May we have roll call, please?
Councilmembers Adams.
Here.
Blackburn.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin.
Here.
Mayor Lutz.
Present. May we have a report of our closed session, please?
Mayor, prior to the meeting this evening, the council met in closed session regarding the one item of labor negotiations listed on the posted agenda. The council did not complete that discussion item, so we're going to go back into closed session at the end of the open session, and then we'll report out after that continued closed session.
Thank you. First item on our agenda is our presentations and proclamations, and this evening we are going to honor some people who have worked on behalf of this community for many years as board members or commissioners. I first want to talk about the people that are not present this evening because unfortunately they were not able to join us, but we have a commemorative thank you plaque for each one of them. And those would be our Planning Commissioner Glenn Owens, who spent the better part of 20 years either working on the commission for the Planning Commission or working with the Planning Commission in some capacity or another. This is a truly very dedicated gentleman who gave a huge part of his life to this community, and we are so grateful for the time and the energy that he gave. We want to thank him very much, so let's give him a round of applause, even though he's not here. We also want to thank our Historic Preservation Commissioner, David Palmeres, who for a number of years has served on the Historic Preservation Commission. And this is a commission that truly gives their passion and their love of historic preservation to each and every item that they have. So this, again, is a labor of love for our commissioner to spend many years on this commission and help us guide this community in all terms of historic preservation through the properties in the area and more specifically with our old town, in preserving the old town and making sure that we're being very sensitive to our historic nature. So let's thank David Palmeres for his commission work on the historic preservation. And finally, another commissioner who is not here this evening is our Old Town Advisory Board commissioner member, Betty Sanford. Now, many of you know Betty has been a longtime contributor and activist in this city for much longer than I should probably give you the number for. Betty has done just about anything and everything in this community, from working on the grassroots level to being a school board member, and then for the last few years has been a commissioner to our Old Town Merchants Association. This is the association that does everything Old Town. They help doing the advertisement. They talk about the programs that happen in Old Town. They are uniquely there to service the businesses in Old Town and collaborate with the city of Monrovia. We are very honored that Betty has spent so many years working as, in this capacity, as an advisory board member. We are going to say goodbye to her in one capacity, but I believe we are going to have her be an, I believe so, no, we're not. Okay, well, Betty has given us many years of service, and we are very grateful for the contribution that she has made to the Old Town Advisory Board, and let's give Betty a round of applause. And now to those commissioners and board members who are present with us this evening. And we have a plaque for each one of you, and I'm going to ask you to come up, and we want to take some photographs with you. I'm going to start with our Old Town Advisory Board. One of our Old Town Advisory Board members who served for the chair of this board, I think almost the entire time he served on this board, is Brian Whelan from Foothill Gym. Brian has done an amazing job collaborating between the city of Monrovia, the merchants in Old Town, and helping them find common ground so that our Old Town can thrive. His dedication has been second to none, and we're very honored to thank him for his years of service from 2004 to 2013. That's a long time of dedication and giving to this community, and we congratulate you, Brian. Thank you. The next board member that is present tonight we would like to thank is board member Andy Ben-Cosme. Andy has been a library board member since 2009. He has dedicated himself to all things library, to helping us with shaping the new library, because he came on just as our new library began. Shaping the new library, looking at the things that work, trying to find new ways to work within the library and build community within the library. And Andy has also dedicated much time and energy to the library board, and we thank you, Andy, for all the time you've given us. And our final board member that is with us tonight is again a library board member, Kristen McClure. Kristen again has come, like Andy, just as we got this new library, with a vision and a dedication to this library. Kristen has very small children who utilize this library, and she was able to really bring that passion that she gets from her children in the library to help us kind of keep us all in tune to that and really understand the purpose of this library and what it really means to the youth of our community, and how we can continue to make this library a living, breathing place for our community. And we thank Kristen for her years of service from 2010 to 2013. Thank you, Kristen. So now if the three of you would come up, we'd like to give you these beautiful plaques and take some photographs with you.
It's very nice. This is Brian Whelan. I was the chairman of MOTAB. I own Foothill Gym right here in Monrovia. Thank you is, having you thank everybody here, it should be the other way around. This is a privilege, and I think everybody should serve in their community as well as it can, both residents and businesses. So I thank you for the opportunity. I have my youngest son, Declan, here. He's five. And I brought him tonight because I hope that he will see the importance as he grows up of being involved and giving to your community. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Let's give them all a round of applause for the dedication that they have given our community. Thank you so much. It's bittersweet. We thank them, but they're not going to be serving any longer in this capacity. And last week we announced the new members of these libraries and boards and commissions. And so we look forward to them serving this community for some time. Our next item is a proclamation for July 2013 as Parks and Recs Month. And this evening we are going to have a special treat. Two of our youth commissioners, Taylor Blackwell and Stephen Garcia, are going to tell us all about that. And as they're coming up to the podium, I would just like to tell you that they are also the youth volunteers of the year. So we congratulate you for that, but are you going to come to the podium and talk to us? Go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Taylor Blackwell, and I'm here with Stephen Garcia. We are excited to accept the Parks Recreation Proclamation. Thank you. We would like to share with you a few of the fun summertime activities happening in Monrovia. On Sunday evenings at 7 p.m. in the library park, the city offers free concerts in the park. There are 8 great bands this summer and concerts start July 7th. Monrovia offers the best parks in the San Gabriel Valley. Each park offers different amenities. For tons of fun, make sure to take a hike to the falls at Canyon Park.
The Community Center offers lots of classes this summer. Some of our favorites include the Lego Camp, Mad Science Club, and Zumba. Many adults and seniors will also have a great summer with their programs and trips, which include clubs, friendly crafters, movies, and a trip to San Antonio Winery. And the big summer event is, of course, the 4th of July concert and fireworks show in Library Park beginning at 7 p.m. For a complete list of all Monrovia has to offer, you can pick up a summer edition of the Monrovia Today, or go online to the city's website at cityofmonrovia.org. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So as you can see, this is perfect to have July be our month for Parks and Recreation, because this is the kickoff for the entire summer events. So we have this beautiful proclamation for you, and I just would like to read it for everybody before we present it to you. Proclamation, City of Monrovia. Whereas parks and recreation makes lives and communities better now and in the future, and whereas parks provide access to the serenity and inspiration of nature and outdoor spaces to play and exercise, and whereas recreation fosters human development, providing positive alternatives for children and youth during non-school hours to reduce crime and mischief, thereby helping the youth develop and grow into healthy and productive adults, and whereas parks and recreation offers places, spaces, and programs, facilitation, social connections, human development, therapy and arts, and lifelong learning, and whereas parks and recreation strengthens community image, a sense of place, and increases cultural unity, and whereas thousands of youth, adults, and seniors benefit from a wide range of services, facilities, and programs, including summer extravaganza, summer concerts, nature and wildlife education programs, classes, and active adult activities provided by the Monrovia Department of Community Services, and whereas the City of Monrovia urges all its residents to recognize that parks and recreations enriches the lives of its citizens and visitors, as well as adding value to the community's homes and neighborhoods. Now, therefore, I, Marianne Lutz, Mayor of the City of Monrovia, along with the entire City Council, do hereby proclaim July 2013 as Parks and Recreation Month, and encourage all residents to use and enjoy our parks and recreational activities. Dated this day, July 2nd, 2013. And we'd like to present this to you. So everybody come on down. Whoa.
or both of you, but you are here. We'll gather around you.
Okay, moving on our agenda, we do not have a student government representative. That will continue in September. Ms. Lyle, do we have any changes to the order of the business?
Yes, Mayor. The council may want to consider moving Councilmember Adams' San Gabriel Mountains report up sooner on the agenda. I think he believes that there might be some folks here that want to discuss that. So we would recommend putting it after the consent calendar, but before public input.
Okay, no problem. We'll go ahead and make that change. Anything else?
Nothing else.
Okay, thank you. Next item is our consent calendar. Before asking for a motion, I do need to recuse myself from consent calendar item CC7. This is an item that is a contract with Huntington Court Reporters, and I just need to report that I have in the past been hired by Huntington Court Reporters as a consultant and a trainer, and even though I do not have a current contract with them or receiving any funds from them right now, I will recuse myself from item CC7 on this consent calendar.
Does that change? I'll move approval.
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
Yes.
Yes.
I would like to discuss item CC4, particularly the need to pay a lobbyist, in particular a federal lobbyist, and what benefit the city gets from that.
Okay, what we'll do then is we'll pull CC4 from the consent calendar, and as our tradition, that will put it at the end of the agenda.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, so we need to ask if the motion, the maker of the motion and the second will agree to that.
That's
change.
Fine.
Yes.
Okay, then if there's any further discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. We are pulling CC4, and I am recusing myself from CC7. Thank you very much. Okay, and at this point, we will move Mr. Adams' report on the San Gabriel Mountains and Watershed National Recreation Area. And Mr. Adams.
Thank you very much. Last week, Councilmember Spicer and I had an opportunity to attend a roundtable meeting put on by Congresswoman Judy Chu regarding her proposed legislation that would create the San Gabriel Mountains and Watershed National Recreation Area. And she was very clear at this meeting that she intends to write this legislation. I think the part that was troubling for me is that the area that would be included in this new federal recreation area includes the Monrovia Wilderness Preserve. And I know there's an awful lot of us that work real hard to create that and had thought that local control would be best, particularly since it was paid for primarily with local dollars. I also note that the Chamber of Commerce has voted unanimously to oppose this because the creation of this recreation area also includes some commercial real estate holdings that are private holdings. And I just feel a little odd that the federal government would end up controlling our foothills. So given that, I would propose that we send Congresswoman Judy Chu a letter asking that Monrovia be excluded from the proposed national recreation area. And I'll make that a motion.
Is there a second?
A second.
I think at this point it might be premature to make a statement such as that while we're still working with her on the legislation and the issue. One of the things that I know she is working with and that we are discussing with her is the fact that the land itself that is owned by not just the city of Monrovia but other cities, that the land does have the local control, and the benefits that would come would not be at an expense of the local control, And I think until we actually see what is put in legislation, I would recommend we wait to see what's actually there first.
Well, I think, in my mind, by the time you see what's in there, it may be too late. One thing's for certain, I can't imagine that there's a benefit to Monrovia in being a part of a national recreation area. We have some pretty specific guidelines that the voters approved for the creation of the Wilderness Preserve. It's not that I think that the Congresswoman has bad intentions, but there's the law of unintended consequence. And once a national recreation area is created and it's handed over to the bureaucrats that run the Department of the Interior, any number of things can happen. And I just don't see that there's a benefit that outweighs the possible loss of control once this becomes law and all the rules and regulations get crafted. No one has been able to share with me what benefit we may get out of including Monrovia lands in a national recreation area. And I asked at the meeting, and no one seems to be able to tell me that there's a benefit to us. So if there's no benefit to us, I don't know why we would want to participate in that.
I think there are some benefits, so maybe what we should do is ask to have somebody come and present to us basically about what the benefits would be, so we can weigh it at well-informed benefits versus what we may feel are concerns. And I'm happy to have us do that at this point.
Well, see, I was under the impression that it was like a question and answer. They were just trying to find out a lot of information prior to taking it forward into legislation. Then she also stated that they would be going out into the community and bringing it to the community, putting it before the community before making any type of decision. Mm-hmm. But I'm looking at waiting on the rest, the continued process just to see if there's going to be any added resources, whether it's through the National Park Service, because right now it seems like it's just up in the air between the U.S. Forestry and the National Park Service, whereas the National Park Service would bring additional funding to it, but that was just some of the options.
But I guess my question is, what would the funding do? I mean, if the National Park Service wants to create or bring funding to the Monrovia Wilderness for a parking lot, we already own the land, we control the land, we have 100% control over the land. I don't know why we would want to give any of that up to some folks back in Washington, D.C.
I agree on control. I mean, and that was one of the issues, and we talked about it, and whether or not we were going to be giving the Santa Monica Conservancy any kind of control. And it was very clear that is a non-starter. I mean, that is definitely against our wishes. At this point, I agree with City Manager Lyle and you, Mayor, that we bring back specifically the concern and get more information as to what benefit, if any, this will provide, and even underscore more our concern about the lack of control of our own. And you had mentioned about the amount of city properties that are involved in this, and not to mix items, but you will hear later about why maybe David Turch and associates could assist us in this situation. But I just don't think we have enough information right now to just say right now we're out to totally reject it. I'd like to have more information, but definitely if we're going to give up our control, that's not a good thing.
Well, once Monrovia lands are part of a national recreation area, we will lose some control.
Mm-hmm. I just like to hear more about the program.
Yeah. Any other comments, questions? We do have a motion and a second before us. I'm going to ask for a roll call vote.
Council members Adams?
Yes.
Blackburn?
Yes.
Spicer?
No.
Mayor Pro Tem Shedlin?
No.
Mayor Lutz?
No.
Thank you.
Any other?
I'll bring the rest of it out later.
Later? Okay.
Thank you.
Can I ask then, is that a directive then? We're going to have that come back to
us
soon?
Absolutely. We will contact the Congresswoman's office and try to get a representative to come and give a presentation, and possibly someone from the Park Service to join them and explain the current understanding of the proposal, and see if we can get a time frame for when something may happen, and get some more information about the potential benefits it drives, specifically for Monrovia.
Right, right, right.
Because the general benefit, I'm not so sure we're so concerned about.
Now, we don't want a general overview. We want to know specifically how it affects Monrovia.
Yes. We'll see if we can do that maybe the August meeting, if not September.
Thank you.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, our next item is our public comment period. At this time, anybody who would like to speak to this council on any item that is not currently on the agenda may do so. What we need you to do is to fill out a blue speaker card, bring it to our city clerk, and she will call your name. Ms. Atkins.
Starting with Lori Beyer.
Hi there. My name is Lori Beyer. I live here in Monrovia, and it's nice to be back. I haven't been back here in a while. I've been here a few times talking about environmental issues and worked with lots of you on A and B and saving our foothills. And I think this is a perfect follow-up to what Tom's talking about in terms of the hillside issue. I'm here today to talk about something that impacts Monrovia, but all of the cities. And that's the plastic bag ban that's going on. I'm very, very proud to be a Monrovian. We preserve our houses, our foothills. We even got our own trucks for the animal control, which we worked really hard for. And as we all know, other cities are following the plastic ban. There's a pathway now. There's a master EIR that people can use. There are ordinances that we can look at. And there's some folks here that know more specifics than I do. But I would like us to, this summer, start the process to look at this. I called each one of you. Becky had some really good questions, and I think a lot of us would like the process to look at those questions, answer the questions. If we decide not to ban plastic bags, that we have a really specific, concrete reason to not do it. And if we do it, we have the same thing. But I see there's a growing interest in the city of Monrovia. I see other cities doing that. And we're so far ahead of the other cities and the other wonderful things that we've done. We have wonderful public works. Everything is top rate. So I'd just like us to be in step with that. And I don't have the answers, but I would like us to start asking the questions. And whatever process that takes, I know you folks are all real busy dealing with all kinds of things and budget issues, but there's a lot of community people that can do some worker bee stuff for you. And I would like to, this summer, take that on and at least start the process of asking the right questions, so when we have the answers, we at least know, and even if we all don't agree with it, at least we know where we stand and the reasons are that we are not banning plastic bags in Monrovia. So that's my request. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amanda Ray.
Hello, Mayor and Council. I'm also here to follow up on the request for to explore the plastic bag ban. And I have just recently started trying to get information. And I know that you probably will be doing the same thing. And I brought with me some information about the city of Pasadena. And I wanted to share that with you. The first thing is, why is the city of Pasadena banned plastic carryout bags? They are produced from non-renewable resources. They are designed to be disposable rather than reusable. They are not likely to be recycled, even though a lot of people say, well, we just put them in the blue bin. Less than 5% of the 19 billion plastic bags used annually in California are recycled. So that means that 95% of the bags are used once and thrown away. They are a significant and visible component of litter. They pollute our local waterways. They are a hazard to wildlife. There is some additional information on the City of Pasadena's website. They are trying to be a green city. And I know that Monrovia has taken steps also to be more green. They have information about which stores are affected. It's not for all stores. It's not for all people either. Lower income people are exempt from paying any kind of a, like a 10 cent charge or whatever the fee would be for a bag. Talks about money collected for the paper bags, that the stores can recoup some of their cost by taking that fee. And then produce and meat bags are not part of that ban, so people would still be able to use those for their groceries. And there's additional information there as well. I did make a preliminary call to the city to find out about what our exact process was for the recycling, too, to get information about that. So I'm hoping to come back to another meeting and have better information for you, too, to help with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ulysses Gutierrez.
Hello, my name is Ulysses Gutierrez, and I live in Monrovia. And I'm also joined today by Michael Martinez from Calvary Chapel, Monrovia. Greetings to the mayor and to the entire city council. Today, I'm here on behalf of the community mediation team, and I joined this team about 3 years ago. And I know it's the first time that I actually come out publicly to speak about the community mediation team, because other community members from the city of Monrovia have taken the time to study what would be the benefit of having a committee that brings together residents and community leaders from the cities of Monrovia, Arcadia, Duarte, and the Los Angeles County unincorporated area. And we have found that the benefits are huge. One of the things that we discovered from 2006 to about 2010, when we had a wave of violence, is that violence or the epidemic does not know borders. It doesn't know geographical lines. It's not going to stop where Fifth Avenue ends for us. It doesn't stop there. It will filter through other communities if we're not aware of what's happening. So the community mediation team meets every third Monday on odd months. So it would be like January and then March, and then it would go on and on. And we meet at the Duarte Public Safety Office. And I personally see it as a hub where, again, community leaders, elected officials, and service providers, including the faith community, gather together to talk about what's happening throughout the community. Any type of community, any type of issues, crises, we talk about it, and then we assess what any other organizations may be doing about the issues at hand. One of the things that I want to talk about is that our last CMT meeting in the month of June, and it's something that we did in 2012 as well, is when we've worked, I'm also a Monrovia Area Partnership leader, and I also represent a project through the YMCA known as the Wildlife Project. And one of the things that we learned as we are out in community and talk to community is that when a wave of violence or criminal activity hits the community, the residents aren't always aware of what's happening. Another thing that was discovered is that not only do the residents don't know what's happening, but there may be clergymen, there could be service providers that aren't aware of what's happening either. And one of the things that we continued to hear time and time again through various community forums is that this is an issue that cannot be only solved by law enforcement, and it's an issue that cannot be solved by elected officials or the city staff. Issues such as criminal activity, gang warfare, however you want to put it, it's going to take community collaboration. It's going to take the power of the group to unite and to continue to look at what symptoms may be out there to prevent another life from being lost or to prevent someone from going to the hospital as it happened on Sunday evening. So one of the things that we've implemented for a second year is a crisis response plan. When there is a natural disaster, there is a natural disaster response. People know where to report to. They know what to do. So I just wanted to come and share it with the city council that both law enforcement agencies that cover the city of Duarte and there's been some participation from the city of Monrovia as well, is that we want to be aware of when a crisis or a criminal act activity happens within the community. We want to be able to manage the information with as many facts as possible and get the information to as many people as possible that are going to roll up their sleeves and go into the community and make sure that either intervention or prevention is happening so another act of violence does not happen. There's four parts to our crisis response plan. One is that we will contact and work with outreach and intervention workers, and I don't have a lot of time to explain what that is, but do know that for the past 2 years, we've spent time in certifying people to know how to work the streets and make sure that they are out there doing what they can to promote peace and save lives. The second is to we have a faith-based component. We encourage the local churches in our community to pray for community, especially if we see any symptoms of crime. And we gather together through the CMT to support initiatives by law enforcement with a focus on violence reduction. And third, if necessary, if any acts of violence happen in a way that is really disturbing the peace of our community, is to call an emergency CMT work meeting to ensure that initiatives are implemented to help community members that are being affected by the violence, as well as making sure that factual information is moving through the community. I'm gonna hand this over to Michael Martinez, who's gonna briefly share about Operation Safe Neighborhoods. I know that with many of you, I've attended meetings where people are talking about what's being done in our local area with AB 109, people that are being released back into our community. And it can't no longer be like, we're not sure, but I think that we're working towards some resolutions.
Thank you. Yeah, Michael Martinez, and I'm part of the faith community, attending Calvary Chapel Monrovia. Operation Safe Neighborhoods, if I could read this, is a Duarte Public Safety Crime Prevention Program in partnership with Wildlife Project. A subcommittee of the community mediation team will host their pilot resource fair on Thursday, July 11th at 7:30 at Pamela Park, 2236 Goodall Avenue, Duarte. The fair will be a one-stop community resource for the formerly incarcerated, AB 109 released, parolees, and individuals identified in local gang injunction. The target population is made up of individuals 18 to 24 years in age that reside in Monrovia, Arcadia, Duarte, and adjacent LA County areas. And it will connect them to over 20 service providers to help them reintegrate into their communities. Providers include LAC Department of Public Social Service, LAC Department of Mental Health, Legal Counsel, Tattoo Removal Services, Substance Abuse Treatment Centers, HIV Testing, Motivational Speakers, and more. Attendees will also receive a free dinner and will be entered into a raffle. Sponsors include LA County Parks and Rec, Duarte's Promise, the Alliance for Youth, and Wildlife Project. For more information, please call Crime Prevention Specialist Ada Torres, 626-359-5671, extension 316. To make Duarte, Monrovia, Arcadia, and an unincorporated neighborhood safe while offering people at the highest risk of violence, real opportunities to turn their lives around. The faith community has met a couple times. We've prayed about this, about what's going on, and we met today. We're gonna have another meeting at Calvary Chapel Monrovia Tuesday. That would be July 9th, 2 days before the call-in event. That'll take place at Pamela Park. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
You guys have any questions? I just want to publicly thank Councilmember Spicer, as he has been before he was a council member, as a commissioner and as a MAP leader. He's been representing our community at those meetings. And again, thank you all for your support throughout the years. And this is something that we're going to continue to work on to continue to make Monrovia the beautiful city that it is. Thank you.
Thank you.
Johansson.
Good evening. My name is Norm Johansson. My wife, Pat, and I are residents of Monrovia. I'm here tonight to encourage you to consider a future ban on plastic bags used by retail stores in Monrovia. You're obviously aware that many Southern California cities have already done so, and many more are considering doing so as well. The environmental damage and costs associated with plastic bags have been documented by others far more eloquently than I can do. In addition to asking you to consider this matter because other communities have already done so, I'm asking that you do so because it's the right thing to do and because I believe Monrovia is a city that strives to do the right thing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Rose Stephenson.
I have a couple of handouts for a little bit later. I'm Rhodes Stevenson. I'm a retiree from JPL. I've lived in the area all my life, or since 1961, actually. I'm here to ask you here at the City Council to consider a reusable bag ordinance. And I have a copy of the Glendale ordinance, which I'll hand out in a few minutes. And it's very similar to that of Pasadena and the county of Los Angeles, and almost identical to the one that passed in LA City a couple weeks ago. Monrovia is a beautiful and environmentally conscious city, and I think by adopting a reusable bag ordinance, you can further enhance the city's environmental image. Most of the surrounding communities now have an ordinance, including LA County, LA City, Pasadena, Glendale, Huntington Beach, Malibu, Santa Monica, and West Hollywood, and many other places. I think about 30% of California is now covered by plastic bag bans. Over 70 cities and counties have adopted bans which are more or less similar or identical. Let me explain that this ordinance applies only to large grocery stores and pharmacies and a few convenience stores. It does not apply to small business. It would promote the use of reusable bags by banning plastic carryout bags. These are the big bags that you use to carry stuff from the checkout counter to your car. It does not restrict the use of these small produce bags that you put your lettuce in or your chicken to try to keep them from contaminating other food. It is supported by the California Grocers Association. They would like to get more uniformity so that different communities aren't all different, and we're, you know, getting on board here. So this would provide more uniformity with surrounding communities. I have two handouts here, which I have seven copies so that the council and city manager can have them. This is a series of frequently asked questions and answers prepared by Heal the Bay. This is an organization that looks out for LA River and the oceans and the beaches. And I also have a copy of the Glendale Ordinance. It's only 5 pages long. You can read it in 5 or 10 minutes. It's very simple. And if you adopted, as I say, I think I've been told the Pasadena and the county are identical. So you just need to change the name, and it's not a lot of work to actually adopt something like this. So,
if you'd like to just hand it to our city clerk, she'll make sure everybody gets a copy of it.
I have 7 copies of each.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. The reason people are focusing on plastic bags is they're the main culprit. And the main reason is they don't decompose for a very long time, and they blow around. They're very light, and they have a lot of area, and they go all over the place. I've been down to the Shoal Canyon landfill, and on a windy day, there are bags just flying everywhere. They get into our storm drains, and get into the storm channels and into the LA River or the San Gabriel River, and they end up in the ocean. And then They end up either on our beaches as litter or various marine animals have been ingesting these plastic bags and dying, and it's a fairly serious problem. I don't have enough copies for everyone. This is what some of our film grains look like. Pass that around. They're just filled with plastic bottles and plastic bags. The other thing I should emphasize, in addition to the environmental benefits, are you could reduce costs to the city of Monrovia and to the county by reducing the amount of litter that gets into the landfills and into the streams. LA County spends $23 million a year cleaning up stuff that blows around the neighborhoods and around landfills and cleaning out the storm drains and the LA River. That could be reduced, and all of us pay county taxes. So if we can save some money for the county as well, and the city could probably avoid some street sweeping and cleanup fees of your own. So this type of ordinance has widespread support. I mentioned Heal the Bay. I have a handout on that. LA Waterkeeper that worries about the LA River. Friends of the LA River, they had a recent cleanup where they had thousands of people along LA River picking up trash, a lot of which were plastic bags and bigger things. And the Sierra Club is also supporting this. So I think this is an idea whose time has come. It's becoming the new norm. And as I said before, Monrovia will then be harmonized with the surrounding communities. So I repeat, please start the process of getting this on the agenda so that you can look into more depth and discuss this at a future meeting. And I'm happy to answer any questions. I've been following this for several years. I'm familiar with what Pasadena and LA City have been doing, as well as the state level.
Thank you.
Kathy Berlin.
Hello, I'm Kathy Berlin, and Mayor Lutz and council members, I appreciate the opportunity to address you. I too am here to encourage you to consider a ban on plastic bags. And it seems to me so appropriate that you do that this month that you've just dedicated to parks and rec and our beautiful wilderness that we all appreciate and enjoy. It will certainly help to preserve that and reduce the cleanup there as well as everywhere else. I won't repeat what all of these other people have said, but I will just tell you that there's a wealth of information out there that we can supply to the council members for your study, and if you just let us know.
Thank you so much.
Helen Romero Shaw.
Good evening, Mayor Lutz and members of the City Council, City Manager, the rest of the city staff. I'm Helen Romero Shaw, Public Affairs Manager, Southern California Gas Company. We do have a branch office here at 141 South Myrtle. I'm here to introduce two of my colleagues. The first one is Tony Tartaglia, Public Affairs Manager. And the other person, here she is, Daisy Cristobal Sanchez, who is the Outreach Manager for our Advanced Meter Project. She's going to give you just a brief update on rolling out the upgraded meters. But first of all, before I formally introduce Mr. Tartaglia, I just want to let you know that the gas company has realigned all our public affairs regions and districts, and I no longer am going to be your representative in the city of Monrovia, along with Arcadia and Sierra Madre. So I'm losing the foothills cities, but I still have seven cities in the San Gabriel Valley, so I'll still be running into you, and I've picked up three cities in southeast LA County. I just want to let you know that I personally have really enjoyed working with you all these 15-plus years, and I really appreciated all the cooperation that I have received from the City Council and Mr. Ochoa, who was the previous city manager, but now Ms. Lyle, who has been very cooperative, and Mr. Bowe, the Public Works Director, has worked with us in so many projects. So it's not goodbye. I'm just going to be, you know, a little bit adjacent to you, to the city. And so this is Tony Tartaglia, your new public affairs manager, and he has his business cards that he's going to leave. And I don't know if you want to say hello or okay.
Madam Mayor, City Council members, City Manager and staff, I know some of you through my other endeavors. I'm the chair of the Foothill Workforce Investment Board, and I've been in your community for several years. I'm a resident of Glendale, so I was happy to take Mr. Ochoa from you and have him as our city manager in Glendale. But I look forward to working with you. Helen and I are still colleagues, and we work very close together. And I actually had Monrovia as one of my cities probably back in the mid-90s. And I love your city. You guys have done a wonderful job when I guess you had Jim Starbird here and others, and you've just, and actually even back to the former city manager of Burbank,
Bud Overham.
So you guys have done a stellar job, and I enjoy working with some of you and enjoy meeting the rest of you very shortly, so thank you. I'd like to have Daisy just talk about what we're doing as far as the advanced meter system here in the city.
Okay. Hello, I'm Daisy Cristobal Sanchez, and I am the advanced meter communications and outreach person. I just wanted to let you know and let the community know that advanced meters are going to start rolling out beginning later this year, so through the end of the year. So you'll see our service trucks out there upgrading your meter. This is a sample of the letter, and I have some copies for this City Council of what you'll get in the mail approximately 30 days before, letting you know that the installation is going to be taking place. If you do have a locked gate or a dog that needs to be confined for safety reasons of our installers, there's a number, a dedicated call center where you can call and schedule an appointment. The customer doesn't need to be home or at their business for it to take place. We don't expect any interruption to service. Once the service is performed, this is not an actual copy, but it's a photocopy of a door hanger that is then left on the door so that you're aware that your meter has been upgraded. I'll leave some fact sheets outside so that way if the constituents want to take a look at that and see what they're going to be getting. But other than that, thank you so much. We are working with the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce, who received a grant from us on this project, and they've been amazing in helping us with outreach to the business community. So thank you so much.
Steve Baker.
Helen, Tony, please don't leave yet. Just hang for a minute. Yes, go ahead, Mr. Baker.
Mayor Lutz, members of the City Council, City Manager, City Staff. I'm Steve Baker, and I come before you this evening as a student of history. 150 years ago, the United States was in the midst of the Civil War, a war to determine its fate as a nation. Gettysburg was the bloodiest battle of the Civil War, fought between July 1st and July 3rd of 1863. It was between the Army of Northern Virginia under the leadership of General Robert E. Lee and the Army of the Potomac under the leadership of Major General George D. Meade. The fighting on July 2nd was the heaviest of the three-day battle and the 10th most bloody battle in the entire Civil War. The combined casualties of Gettysburg were as follows: killed, 7,863. Wounded, 27,224. Missing in action, 11,199. For a total of 46,286 men impacted by that battle. I'd like to suggest that we pause for a minute this evening to remember those who fought and died 150 years ago so that we might live in one united nation. For those wishing to commemorate the events of 150 years ago, the Emancipation Proclamation and the Battle of Gettysburg, There will be a gathering at the Monrovia Historical Museum on Sunday, July 14th, between 1 and 4 p.m. Civil War soldiers will be there, in addition to Abraham Lincoln, Mary Todd Lincoln, and Senator Ninian Edwards. Thank you.
Thank you.
No more speaker cards.
We do not have any other speaker cards at this time. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council? You may come forward.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Karen Suarez of Monrovia, and it is very nice to hear members of the community to come up and speak about a plastic bag ban in Monrovia. It is something that I have been interested in for years. I approached Manager Ochoa about it, and if you could help me remember what year the wrought iron fence was put in around the City of Hope, it was around that time. Years ago, and I attended stakeholder meetings in Los Angeles to hear what was going on in the preliminary discussion there, and I was pretty disappointed how long it took to get a pretty basic environmental decision done. But then I have also talked to other Monrovia city officials, and I was pretty much told that as it progresses with other cities in the League of Cities in Los Angeles, it would probably be easier to implement here. And so I think now is a really good time to start considering the grocery store plastic bag ban option. I have years of documented emails to our supervisor Antonovich of the plastic bags in the wash behind my house. They're quite a blight. They are an environmental hazard, and it's something that residents have become very accustomed to, being able to walk in the store and not have to remember to take a shopping bag. But it's been common practice in Europe for years. It's nothing new, and we would not be by any stretch of the means on the forefront of this issue. Many cities have already adopted this. And so I would encourage you to please have a look at moving quickly on proposing a plastic bag ban in Monrovia for the major shopping grocery stores. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to speak to this council? Please come forward.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council. My name is Pam Fitzpatrick, 412 South Myrtleland. You know, Thursday we have this great event, fireworks show, the concert in Library Park. It's going to be great. You know, from last year, the folks start coming to the park early in the day, reserving their space. It's such an important event for our community. And I'd like you all to remember Old Town when you do this. Remember that many of our Old Town businesses, unlike years past, will be open on the 4th of July. And I would like you to share with your friends and relatives that when they picnic in the park, when they come down for the concert, everybody has to eat, and we have fine restaurants here. You can take to-goes and make sure that you remove your plastic bags, please, because we don't want to have to clean them out of the park. And also remember that we have an Old Town website, oldtownmonroviaca.com, and tomorrow there'll be an updated, which is an ever-changing list of those merchants who have told me that they're going to be open, and I promise that I would share that information. So we'll post it on the Old Town website. So you'll know, and I'll bet you, you'll find some fun things for families and kids, as well as things to eat in our Old Town stores. So please support your local small business. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else who'd like to speak to this council on any items that are not currently on our agenda? Seeing and hearing none, I will close this portion of the agenda, and we will move on to our reports of city council members. I'll begin with Mr. Adams, if you'd like to continue your report.
Thank you. Just one brief last thing. There's a free electronic waste recycling event that will be down at the Park and Ride lot, sponsored by the City of Monrovia and the Monrovia Chamber. It will be Saturday and Sunday, July 27th and 28th from 9 to 3. It's a great event. You don't have to lift anything. You just pull up. They take all your electronic waste out of your car. They do not take hazardous waste. So please take advantage of that for recycling. And that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Spicer.
Yes, Mayor Lutz. I had the opportunity this within the past couple of weeks to be able to tour the different departments within the city, administrative services, the police department, community services, public works and utilities. And I was also involved in a live demonstration with the fire department, which was kind of interesting, you know. So we worked with this dummy, and you know, we had to just compress
CPR.
Yeah, it was like CPR, but hey, Mayor, you know, the guy, I'm waiting on the guy to go through the counting of, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, and all, right? And I'm sweating, you know, I'm sweating going through this whole process. And I'm thinking to myself, well, when are he's going to say we're going to make a change? You know, but we went on another 20 seconds, finally made a change. And when he said, are you ready to switch up again? You know, I wasn't all for it. And, you know, but... Hey, I give a lot of accolades to the departments. I thank them for sharing, you know, giving me the opportunity to learn about the different departments. And I also went on a tour of the Athens Recovery Facility. Mm-hmm. And they had issues with the plastic bags, but I don't want to get into that either. But we do need to work on that. And lastly, Mayor, I would like to congratulate you on being elected to the chair of the Women Mayors.
Oh, thank you.
Chair of the Women Mayors. And that's all for my report.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin. I knew it was an S word.
Okay. I'll just repeat it. I know that several in the audience this evening have talked about the events that are coming up in the next couple of weeks. But again, our 4th of July event that's coming up this Thursday, come out and just have a great time. If you haven't been there, you've really missed something very special. And at 6:30 p.m., there's music, a DJ, that's at 6:30 p.m., and then live concert at 7 to 8:30, and then fireworks at 9, and it's really a great event. Come on out and participate. And then Sunday the 7th, we start our first of our summer concerts in the park, and the first one is The Basics, and it's Top 40 Hits. So come out, and that's from 7 to 8:30 at the Band Shell in Library Park, and that's great fun, too. And then, like Steve said, on the 14th, we have our, at our museum, the Emancipation Proclamation celebration of the 150th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation from 1 to 4. So please check that out. I am the liaison to the Foothill Transit Board, and currently I am sitting on the executive board, and I just wanted to share some things that are going on with Foothill Transit. Foothill Transit is a joint powers authority of 22 members, cities in the San Gabriel and Pomona Valleys, and it was created in 1988 after the former Southern California Rapid Transit District, RTD, announced service cuts and fare increases that would negatively impact the San Gabriel Valley. And so in an effort to provide better transportation options for the community while reducing costs and improving local control, the Los Angeles County Transportation Commission, approved Foothill Transit's application to assume operation of 14 lines. Well, at any rate, they've come in the last 25 years, they've come a long way. But in their inception, they decided that they would contract out their management. And they've gone along all these years with having a contract management. Well, as of yesterday, they've brought their management in, and they are fully operational. They are their own team in-house. and they did it in a very short window and brief window, and it's gone very, very smoothly, and very proud of the organization. Doran Barnes was the director before, and he is continuing on as the director in their in-house management. I also wanted to share with you at the last executive board meeting, we authorized the purchase of 12 electric Ecoliner buses. Originally in 2011, through a federal grant, they purchased three buses, and they thought they'd be able to purchase 9 more, but because the cost and the production, it's far more efficient, we're able to buy 12. And so there will be a completely electrified line in Foothill Transit, and that's quite an accomplishment. They also are going to be buying more CNG buses, the compressed natural gas, and they will be eliminating all diesel buses than the remaining diesel buses. So some exciting things going on at Foothill Transit. So I just wanted to let you know about that. And then on June 12th, as the alternate to the COG, although I normally try to go as alternate or otherwise, to the COG strategic planning retreats, and on June 12th, they had one of these retreats. Marianne was in Washington, D.C. at the time. But I wanted to share some notes with you from the retreat. And this year's retreat provided an opportunity for the group to reaffirm the commitment to the mission statement and to the core values and guiding principles, and identify priority areas for the COG. And also, because they have hired a new executive director, it's given a chance for the members to then give input back to the executive director and her staff as to really how they would like them to carry on or focus more on some strategic items. So I just wanted to share quickly with you, the mission statement did not change. It's the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments is a unified voice to maximize resources and advocate for regional and member interests to improve the quality of life in the San Gabriel Valley. Core values and guiding principles, reflecting the diversity of our member communities, accountability, mutual respect, integrity, unity of common goals and objectives, collaboration, fiscal responsibility, transparency, being proactive, and results-oriented. You wouldn't believe how much discussion was using the word proactive. A lot of people have a different idea of what proactive means, and providing creativity and problem-solving. There were 36 strengths and accomplishments that were discussed, one of which, as I just mentioned, bringing in a brand new executive director, Andrea Miller, and she did come before this council just recently to introduce herself. There were 25 benefits discussed of belonging to the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments, one of being strength in numbers, speaking with a stronger voice, and obtaining recognition of this region as a player in developing regional solutions, lobbying as a group on bills and issues, assisting with grant funding, financial benefits to our city and areas that cities can't in areas that cities can't afford. Those are just some of the benefits. And we identified 39 priority areas. There are a lot of areas, but we narrowed that down in no order of priority. But transportation, infrastructure, health, air quality, mobility options, bicycle infrastructure, economic development, including homeless, senior housing, jobs, small business issues, revenue, new legislation, environment, air quality, health, recreation, energy, solid waste management, sewer, natural disasters and sustainability, water involving sewer and sustainability, and public safety, realignment issues, natural disasters, emergency preparedness, and public relations and best practices. And as you can see, and if I told you all 39 nine of them. You can see there's a lot of crossover there. So these strategic meetings and planning sessions are very important to us to participate in and to give the COG direction in these areas. And they have them every 6 months, and the next one will be set in December of this year or possibly early January 2014, and we'll be bringing back more info. But I did want to share with you one of the items that was discussed at this meeting had to do with involvement of city council members. You don't have to just be the alternate or the designated person to be involved. Same thing with staff. They like to have, there are staff members that are present at these strategic planning meetings as well. And just recently, the COG, or through Ms. Miller, she had contacted the membership and saying they're calling for participation and nominations for the San Gabriel Valley COG ad hoc committees. And it had to do with realignment and court consolidation, ad hoc committee, and national pollutant discharge elimination system, municipal separate storm sewer systems. And so if people are interested in serving in any of these ad hoc committees, you can submit your name by Tuesday, July 9th. And if you need information on that, you could, I suppose, contact city staff, or you can contact me, BeckySheblin@gmail.com. But in another area of benefit, our mayor, Marianne Letts, is going to highlight some other areas that the COG is being very instrumental in providing a benefit to its membership. And I did want to say congratulations on the election, but happy birthday tomorrow.
Thank you.
I just kind of thought I'd slide
thank
that
you.
In there. and thank you very much, and happy 4th to everybody.
Councilmember Blackburn.
Sure. Thank you. Two things. I guess one is an item that I'll report on. The other is a comment on the plastic bag issue, actually. With regard to the community item, I'd like to make everybody aware that the Monrovia Rotary Club, which is a local service organization, is holding a fundraiser for its charity account on September 7th at the community center. It's going to be a casino night, which I assure you is entirely legal. So there is an auction component of it. So if you have items that you would like to donate, feel free to contact me directly, and I will take those on behalf of the club. If you would like to attend, we'd love to have you in attendance. This is the second annual casino night. The first year was very successful. And it was a lot of fun. It's Western themed, so you get dressed up in your cowboy hats and boots. I know you still have those from the 80s when you used to go line dancing, so break them out and, you know, come on out. The second item is the plastic bag issue. In my mind, this is a no-brainer. It's a classic generator of a negative externality. Negative externality is essentially a creator of a negative effect upon others that the doer or the creator of the effect doesn't take into account. I think it's socially primitive, myopic, and childish way of living to simply pollute behind you as you go through life without consideration for other people. You know, it's sort of ironic and kind of interesting that, you know, we teach our children to be considerate, to cover their mouths when they cough, to not make too much noise in public, to not interrupt, to generally be considerate of others. And then we as adults take the liberty of acting like children, of not taking others into account, and justifying that behavior on quasi-dime store philosophical grounds that are really just transparent excuses to behave selfishly. I can't see any possible reason for not implementing this ban other than we're just too lazy to take a few moments to think before we go to the grocery store. I'm guilty of that sometimes. I try to do what I can to minimize the use of those bags, but I think it would be very helpful. So. To implement the ban itself. So thank you for showing up, and thank you for your input. I appreciate it.
Thank you. I have a lot of items, and both of my colleagues on each side of me have added things that they forgot to mention, so my list got longer. First thing on my list of items tonight is, as we have made a change in the way we are looking at and attending conferences throughout our year, we had made a decision with our budgeting that we will, for our conferences, have the appointed person and the alternate to that entity attend the conferences, and in some cases we've added a third person, such as the case we have coming up in September, which is the California League of Cities annual conference, September 18th through 20th. The current designated voter on that position is Alex Blackburn, and I believe the alternate is Larry Spicer. So we need to know if each of you are going to and are planning to attend. And then we did designate that this is a conference where multiple people attending is very beneficial because there's multiple items going on simultaneously at this conference and educational items simultaneously. So I'm going to ask Councilmember Blackburn if he is intending to attend this conference.
I am.
You are. Mr. Spicer, are you attending? Yes. To? Then we have one more space available for a council member who would be interested in attending. Ms. Shevlin is interested. Mr. Adams, are you interested at all?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
I will defer to Ms. Shevlin. So attending that conference will be Mr. Blackburn, Mr. Spicer, and Ms. Shevlin. Great. Thank you all very much for that. We will not bring every conference like this, only when we have an opening or if the delegate or their alternate has indicated that they're not going to be able to attend, and then we will open it up to the other council members to see if they can attend, because the most important thing we feel is that we are at these educational conferences to bring information back to our city and to move us forward. I also would like to report that in the last week we have had performance evaluations of both our city manager and our city attorney, and we are very happy to say that they both passed with flying colors, and we're happy that we will be continuing with them. Some people may be asking compensation-wise. We have had a very rough budget year, as most of you have know from watching this, and so there will not be any changes in compensation, but we want to thank them very most for the work that they're doing, and we're looking forward to working with both of you in the future. Also, I want to report on my conference that I attended last week at the U.S. Was it just last week? I guess it was. The U.S. Conference of Mayors. This is a jam-packed four-day conference. It was held in Las Vegas, Nevada, but I assure you I never left the hotel. These conferences start at 7 o'clock in the morning, and they run all day. Then there's evening sessions as well, so they're full bore. And I want to highlight a few things that I think are important for our council. All of our council and most of our city staff have received a recap from myself regarding the activities of the conference, but there are a few things I'd like to highlight for everybody. First and foremost, as I tell you about the Mayor's Water Council that I am a member of and a very active member of, there are two reports that the U.S. conference has printed up in the last few months. One is about procurement with regard to water infrastructure, and the other document is with regard to the spending that municipalities are spending with water, wastewater, stormwater, and infrastructure. And they're both very helpful in letting us know kind of where we sit proportionally wise in our spending and our procurement policies. And so that was discussed at great length there. We also, we authored a resolution to be taken to the U.S. Conference of Mayors, and it was entitled Supporting Consideration of Fiscal Impacts in Establishing Compliance Schedules for the U.S. EPA Permits and Developing Federal Funding for Planning, Monitoring, implementing of the U.S. permit requirements. As many of you know, as you've been listening to us over the last few months, we have a huge permit that has that we are now under, which is most cities of Los Angeles are under, which is a permit regarding our stormwater. This permit will cost our municipality, we estimate, between $2 and $5 million per year to meet. It's a huge number, and there is no funding source for this. We are not the only city having these permits being brought among them. Across the nation, they're happening all over the place. So the U.S. Conference of Mayors has really started taking a very strong voice to these issues, trying to find some resolution, either with funding sources from Congress, these are federal permits based under the Clean Water Act, or having them permits be correlated to funding mechanism, which means if you have the money, you do it. If you don't, you wait till you get the money kind of thing. So these are the kind of things that this Water Council works very, very strongly with. And I'm happy to say that our resolution passed unanimously in the Water Council and then again at the Environment Committee and then was taken directly to the entire membership of the mayors and was passed unanimously. So that now is a policy of the U.S. Conference of Mayors that is shared with presidents, congress members, senators all throughout the nation. So we're very happy that that step is taken. And then as an aside, we have also taken that same resolution and we have written it to a state level, and that will be coming before the League Conference that I spoke about earlier. It'll be a resolution at the League Conference in which Mr. Blackburn will be making our vote on whether to support that resolution. So we're hoping that that will go through the same kind of process at the state level with the League of California Cities. So that's another issue. There was quite a bit of discussion about the stormwater issues, and in the East Coast, it's not just stormwater, but it's hard to explain, but their actual stormwaters is also their wastewater, which means the water that goes down your drains in some cities in the East Coast commingles with your stormwater, and they have to purify and cut the pollutants out before it goes out of their pipes. So we have two different places where ours go, they have one, and they're under the same restrictions that we are at the same time. So it's different, but it's the same. Then we went to the Environment Committee, where there was a really good presentation about city fleets and cars and alternative vehicles. We have a policy in Monrovia about fleets and alternative vehicles here. And this city, which is Indianapolis, has taken virtually the same policy we have and has really, really applied it very well. So I've asked our city manager to look at the process that Indianapolis is using. They estimate that they've saved millions of dollars in the last couple of years by implementing fleets that are hybrids and CNG vehicles and electric vehicles. So it's something that behooves us to look at and see if there's some mirroring that we can do there. As Councilmember Spicer and Mayor Pro Tem Shevlin indicated, when we were joined with the other women mayors across the country, I was elected to the chair of this body and this committee. So I'm very proud to be elected as the chair of the committee, and this will be a position that I hold for the next 2 years in this entity. I also attended a workshop that had to do with technology, which was an amazing workshop that talked about all kinds of technologies, some of them at low cost or no cost to our city, that would help us communicate better with our residents. And so Ms. Lyle and I talked about that. We're going to be looking more into some of those things to see if there are things that we can add without any cost, because we have this budget issue, if you haven't noticed. Then the next thing I went to was a small business franchise and entrepreneur task force. And this was very fascinating. I met with a couple of people who work with small businesses in a couple of different arenas, one with franchises and the other with small businesses. And when they say small businesses, they mean like Monrovia businesses. They mean the businesses that we have in Old Town. They mean the small you and me businesses. And they go into the areas and they actually have very, very strong seminars to help the business owners find ways to make their business sing. And again, Ms. Lyle and I talked about that, and we're going to be looking in to see how what we can do to bring some of these resources to our area. And we'll probably coordinate with the Chamber of Commerce, or even we talked about the Council of Governments to bring them to a larger group to get more bang for their buck for that, to get them to our area. We had a wonderful speakers at this conference. We always do. The first speaker that we had, the Vice President Biden was there, who spoke to us on a myriad of issues. Transportation was one of the largest issues he talked about. And we also then were addressed by Congressmember Bill Schuster, who is the transportation chair. And he it was the first time he had addressed this body, and he talked about the broad scopes of transportation and how we need to look at this in a big holistic manner across the whole country. And transportation needs on the East Coast may be different than on the West Coast, but we need to find the right mechanism in finding and funding transportation across this country. And that was a very, very informative discussion. We also, there was a discussion about Vietnam and Vietnam veterans. I don't know if anybody really has caught this. I did not until this presentation. It is the 50th anniversary of the ending of the Vietnam War, and there is a plan to really do some kind of commemorating of this, and we will be looking at how we as a community can thank our Vietnam veterans and collaborate in this sense. And then I was, along with all of that, there were numerous grants and offerings that we will be looking into that we can help try to fund our projects that we are doing here in Monrovia. So overall, it was a very full 4 days, and I think we definitely get a lot of information from these conferences, and I was very happy to attend that on behalf of our city. Next, we have, as you've been listening to several people talk about the 4th of July event, which will be on Thursday. The 4th of July event is a wonderful event with fireworks, and humans love it. Pets, however, not so much. So one of the things that we do want to remind you is if you have a pet who is not happy with the fireworks, there are places you can go. I think it's Wonder Dog Ranch, which will you can take your dog to Wonder Dog Ranch, which is a little further away than the fireworks, and they will help you contain them. But please remember, maybe keep them inside that evening if the fireworks do bother them, because we know we love them, but we want to be sensitive to our friends who are a little smaller than us. But I hope to see everybody out at the fireworks on Thursday. We have usually huge crowds, and I don't expect that to change. But thank you for coming. Also, in July, we have a very special event coming. The Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center at the high school. As many of you know, we had a bond measure, and we all voted to upgrade our high school a few years ago. And they did an amazing job upgrading the auditorium, the sound, the lights. Everything about that auditorium is state of the art. Their very first performance is the Louise K. Taylor Performing Arts Center will be this July. It is the Music Man. And it will play July 18th, 19th, and two shows on Saturday the 20th. If you're interested in tickets, there's two ways you can go. First, you can, they're all online, so you buy your tickets online. Brownpapertickets.com is one way. Just go there and go to the Arts Performing Arts Center. Or you can go to the website for the Performing Arts Center, and there's a link. And that is LK Taylor, T-A-Y-L-O-R, performingarts.com. If you didn't catch any of that, call the Unified School District. They'll be happy to direct you. Tickets are available now, and you can also buy them right up until the door time, I believe. But it should be a great show. Help support art in Monrovia. This is our first step and our very first performance in our Performing Arts Center. And last but not least, as Ms. Shevlin had reminded me, the Monrovia Reads will be having a fundraiser on July 20th, their annual chili cook-off. And if you have not got tickets for Monrovia Reads chili cook-off, all you need to do is go online, monroviareads.com, I believe it is.
Org,
one or the two.
I should know that.
If one doesn't work, the other will. And you can get tickets for that. But it's always a great event and lots of good chili. And one more thing. Oh, I think Mr. Spicer brings up a good point. We had a lot of people here this evening talking about the paper bag, the plastic bag ban. And as many of you already know, when we have public comment, we don't really engage in dialogue at this point. But I just want everybody to know that we have heard your what you've had to say, and I assume we'll be bringing this item up and be moving forward or doing something with it. So I think just keep tuned and let us know how you feel as we move along. Okay? And that concludes my report, finally.
Mayor,
with that,
Mayor, yes. I think you asked Ms. Shaw to stay. Is there?
I did. I'm sorry. Thank you for that. I am sorry.
She's after sitting there thinking.
Yes, I moved on from the public comment. I wanted to. I apologize, Helen.
Oh, no, okay.
I wanted to thank you for all the years of service that you have given to our community as our representative from Southern California Gas Company. We have been spoiled by your attention, by your work with us and our coal community, and we truly appreciate you and wish you luck with the other communities you're going to be with. And Tony, who did not stay, I want to welcome him, and we look forward to working with Tony in the future as well. I know a few of us do know him, and that'll be an easy transition, but we will absolutely miss you.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate your kind words.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Helen. Okay, did I get everything? All righty, we will now move on to the Monrovia Financing Authority meeting without adjourning the City Council, and we will take up roll call, please.
Board members Adams.
Here.
Blackburn.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Vice Chairman Shevlin.
Here.
Chairman Lutz.
Present. Consent calendar.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, this passes. And now we'll move right on to the Monrovia Housing Authority meeting, and we will take up roll call of Monrovia Housing.
Board members Adams.
Here.
Blackburn.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Vice Chairman Shevlin.
Here.
Chairman Lutz.
Present. Consent calendar.
Move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. This passes. And we will now reconvene the Monrovia City Council meeting. And at this point, we will take up the pulled items from our consent calendar, and it is the consent calendar item number 4. So, Ms. Lyle, do you want to kind of start out and give us a discussion, or would you like Ms. McLean to?
I can handle
okay.
the discussion. The City of Monrovia has utilized the services of two lobby firms in the past few years. One is a lobbyist at Sacramento, Joseph Gonzalez and Son, and the other that we have used in Washington, D.C. is David Turch and Associates. And given our current budget issue, we have been in contact with both of the lobbyists and requested that they consider changing their fee structure to better accommodate our budget constraints. And both lobbyists were willing to do that for us. However, at the present time, the staff is suggesting that our agreement with Gonzalez is not providing that benefit at this point of in relationship to the cost that we bear. And so we're not recommending continuing with that agreement. However, we are recommending that we continue our arrangement with David Church and Associates. Our ability to lobby Washington, D.C. is more difficult than it is to lobby in Sacramento, and I believe that they have been very helpful in assisting us with especially getting access to certain of the federal departments that would be helpful for us to try to resolve some of our issues. For instance, the mayor and Jennifer McClain were there earlier in June and met, had 3 days of meetings pretty much back to back. And some of them were with our local elected officials. However, many of them were with federal agency staff or representatives from other agencies or other areas that would be difficult for us to get access to those departments. And so the investment we make in David Church and Associates, we think, is a good investment for us. I think the National Recreation Area coming forward, it would also behoove us to have a Washington lobbyist for that legislation. And so staff is recommending that we continue that relationship. Mr. Church has agreed to reduce his retainer by $500 a month. And so we are going to suggest that we enter into this new agreement at a somewhat reduced rate. Now, I know Mr. Church is here. If you have questions, he would be very happy to respond to those questions. But we do believe that the cost is certainly well worth the benefit that we derive from that relationship at the present time. So I can answer questions. I know Mr. Church can. And that concludes the report. We're recommending approval of that professional services agreement, but no longer continuing with the relationship with Gonzalez.
Did you have any specific questions, Mr. Blackwell?
I do. So, as a basic matter, I would like to know how many hours per month we use Mr. Church's organization, so I have a better idea for what that breaks down to on an hourly basis.
We contact their office, maybe not consistently every month. For instance, last month we probably spent 40 to 50 hours to try to, that they used to try to secure the meetings with the various departments. Mr. Church's employee, Jamie Jones, frequently visits us here in Monrovia, so he's here about every month or 6 weeks, and we spend several hours with him. When we have an issue, they spend time trying to resolve the issue. So over the course of the entire year, my guess is that they spend about 100 hours specifically on Monrovia, and then indirectly they also represent other San Gabriel Valley and other Southern California cities, and they represent our interest at large to our elected officials as well. But certainly David could answer more specifically how many hours that they do spend. That's an estimate on my part based on the working relationship that we have. But if you'd like a specific accounting, he is probably more able to provide that to you.
So the other question I have is, if this is, it sounds like a lot of the issues that Mr. Turch lobbies on our behalf with regard to are regional issues. Why is he not a regional lobbyist paid for by multiple cities in the area who have aligned interests? For example, the water permit, the fact that that's an unfunded mandate, that's a regional issue. The National Recreation Area, that's a regional issue. Why are we footing the bill perhaps individually as cities? It seems like there's potentially a lot of redundancy of effort there, and I can see that Mr. Turch may want to respond to this in the near future.
Mr. Turch.
Well, Mayor, members of the council, good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for listening to me, or I guess at my time it's good morning.
I know.
No, it's fine. I slept 3 or 4 hours last night before I came here from Minneapolis. I think that your point is well taken, that these are in fact not just regional issues, but they're national issues. But they have an absolutely direct impact on this community. So it doesn't matter that New York or Pittsburgh or my little town of county, actually, we don't have towns in Virginia, but Fairfax County, Virginia, also has the same problem. This community is going to spend, by your estimate, $2 to $5 million per year. And we are suggesting and have worked out with city staff a two-pronged approach to solve your problem. One really does, to your point, have a regional and national impact. That is, we will support Jim Bishop's proposal that will provide some funds and some modification for that requirement to you. That's national in scope. we'll do the best we can. On a regional basis, we have suggested to city staff that the mayor and members of the council should be meeting with some of our good friends elsewhere in the LA Basin. We are the dominant public sector firm, at least by numbers of clients in the LA Basin, so you're quite correct. We do have a regional impact. How that matters to you is that I will have direct access to people like Ken Calvert and Gary Miller, who'll be happy to sit down with members of this community and talk about how this problem could be solved. That will take you to, in the end, we think, Kevin McCarthy, who is third ranking in the hierarchy of the House, and having that kind of juice matters nationally. Now, more specifically, we'd also do this on a micro level. I employ full-time a person I think none of you have ever heard of, but he's been with me almost 20 years. His sole job is to analyze all of the federal money and bills that come down and to find pots of money that could be useful to you in meeting your $2 to $5 million obligation. I have no idea where those things are. He's a whole lot smarter than am I, and he has a lot more time to look at it than do I. So in the end, the national government is so different than your government here. You have tonight had to publish an agenda and tell the people in the citizens of this community what you're going to discuss. We don't have to do any of that on the national level. Things happen sometimes with a half hour's notice. I can recall a real example some years ago. We had until May to submit our transportation requests, and on a Thursday afternoon, the committee called me and said, 5 o'clock tomorrow. Unless you're there, you can't meet that deadline. So we'll see what we can do in providing specific money. We'll see what we can do. Also, your point well taken on a regional and national level. We'll cooperate for the benefit of the citizens of this community. And Councilmember Adams, the same thing really applies to the business of the recreation area. It is up to you to decide. This is above my pay grade. I and the people who work with me are your servants. You decide what's in your best interest, and then we will move to modify that bill, help to promote that bill, or kill it. Actually, I'm best at killing things, but.
Me too.
Now, could I add one other thing? If I could just throw out a little bit of self-promotion, because what would a lobbyist be without some self-promotion? We have reduced, not just this time, because we consider ourselves a part of this community. So this is the second time in a couple of years we have reduced the fee. And the fee we're proposing is, in rough dollars, one-third of what the fee was a couple of years ago. And what's more, we're prepared to accept that for 2 years out, so you don't have to worry about us jumping that fee by a large amount 12 months from now. And I promise to you, there will be no reduction in service for the reduction in fee. But a couple of years from now, when things are much better, I'm going to talk to you about money. And I promise you that, too.
Okay. Thank you very much.
One more pitch. The return on investment is, in rough dollars, I think we've returned something in the vicinity of $7 million over the terms of this contract to this community. Happy to answer anything else, but hearing no other questions, I want to thank you again.
Thank well, actually,
one more question, Mr. Church. Looks like
question.
There's one more. You didn't get away fast enough, yeah. Mr. Blackburn.
So, I don't doubt that your firm does excellent work, and
thank you.
Deserves to be paid for the work that they do. Still, though, based on what you've said, what I hear is that you've been successful, or that you haven't said that, but presumably, at lobbying on regional issues that affect us regionally. So what I'm still asking is, why don't we employ you on a regional basis? Why are we recreating the wheel city by city and paying for potentially double paying or triple paying, or however many cities there are in a region that are affected by one particular issue that you go lobby for? That's my question to the city council and to city staff.
Well, I could really address that directly by saying some of your issues are very specific. The Wilderness Preserve was very specific to this community. The town square was very specific to this community. The skateboard park was very specific to this community. The trolley, very specific to this community. The downtown revitalization on Myrtle, very specific to this community. So it's not, some of the things have regional impact. Most of what we do is very specific to the citizens of this community.
Yeah, I appreciate your background, and I'm not familiar with how you contributed to those issues that you mentioned. I'm sure you did. If you could elaborate on what it is that your firm did to help us with those issues, that'd be great.
Well, I think this is really a teamwork proposition, and in which we work very closely with the elected officials, you as representative. In the end, we are responsible to the citizens of this community as exemplified by their elected leaders, meaning you. It's been a teamwork effort. We're very grateful that you've taken the trouble to come to Washington. Some of those trips have been more exciting and interesting than others, at least memorable. In any event, all of this has mattered, and I would say, because it's a team effort, because we're coordinating with so many people, members of Congress, elected officials on the local level, as you point out, sometimes regional people, I don't know that I can say if I wasn't there, nothing would happen. But I think had I not been there for any of the things that I mentioned, it would have been very much more difficult, and although I can't point to one, my guess is that a good number of these wouldn't have happened had you not had that kind of coordination. And I can expand a little bit by saying I have people on staff, for instance, former Congressman Todd Tehart from Kansas, very high ranking on the Appropriations Committee, the former Chief of Staff to Jim Oberstar, the Chairman of the House Transportation and Infrastructure Committee. We've just hired the legislative aide and campaign manager to one of the Republican candidates for the U.S. presidency last time out, who gives us access really to House leadership. So in that sense, do any one of those people ever absolutely make something happen for me? It's really cooperative, but it's also cooperative. So we're kind of all together in the teamwork together, and all I can say is my best guess, very truthfully, is a good number of those things would not have happened had I not been involved, but I can't point to one where lightning might not have struck.
But I do know in years past we've had more than one member of Congress say, if you can find the money, I'll be happy to vote for it. That they won't have their staff, nor will they spend the time to identify the quagmire of funding back there. But I think you bring up an interesting point, Alex, and I don't know, does the COG have a lobbyist?
No, the COG does not. And I might just share one of the things that when I am back in Washington and talking to Congress members, one of the things that I hear them say is, well, you're the first person to talk to us about this. And so there is sort of a numbers game there where you've got to get a lot of different people, a lot of different lobbyists talking about the same thing. But you're correct. The COG does not have its own lobbyists. The League has lobbyists that speak to specific issues. The Gold Line has a lobbyist that speaks to specific issues. But
maybe we should bring that up with the COG, because the economies of scale can be enormous.
It may be something the COG may be looking at. But at this point, I do not believe that they're looking, that's on their agenda to hire a lobbyist at this point.
But I think it's a good idea, and I'm volunteering. I'll add them.
And you'd like us to submit your name. I'm ahead of you on that one.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Perhaps we could
I could certainly have a discussion at the COG about that. That's very easy discussion to have.
There's going to be a substantial savings if we can get that done.
Yeah. Well, that was one of the benefits as lobbying as a group.
Yeah,
it wasn't that they had specifically a lobbyist.
Right.
But they will go and like some of the cities will, we will, what the COG does is they go as a group and they get all the lobbyists from the different cities kind of banding together to take them to these entities because as I've been a member of that COG for 10 years, and there has never been a lobbyist of the COG, per se. But they coordinate with other lobbyists at different times for different topics.
Maybe now's the time.
And there are regional things, but there are those opportunities, though, that are specific to Monrovia or a specific city that maybe another member city in the COG does not want to be paying a lobbyist to be representing Monrovia. So in that case, Mr. Church does bring benefit on those individual items that are just specific to Monrovia.
Could I just also, just my experience is that the larger the organization and the more you have to outreach to a broader group of Congress people on behalf of that organization, the bigger the job and the higher the contract, the larger the contract. So whether or not we would actually achieve a savings by having a regional because we are looking at asking Mr. Church to contact 10, maybe, congressional members on our behalf on the specific issues that we have. When those are broadened to more Congress people, that increases, maybe not exponentially, but it increases the number of people that need to be outreached and contacted and lobbied and worked to in order to represent the full scope of that issue on a regional level. So I don't believe that if we went that route that our cost would be 1/30th or 1/10th even of the cost that we would incur here. The other consideration is that even though in the last 5 years, there really has been a very strong avoidance by Congress of earmarks, I think that notion is coming back. And our ability to take advantage of that, there are limited opportunities and windows for us to do that. And so if we are going to be successful at taking advantage of any opportunities that arise, we will be more successful with a lobbyist than without a lobbyist, because we don't have the staff to be able to even identify those opportunities when they arise. So that is another consideration that I would really hope the council thinks about when you're making this decision.
Yeah, and let me just say that's simply because I ask a question, pointed questions, and
absolutely
firmly and difficultly, doesn't mean that I've made up my mind at all. Mm-hmm. Just seeking out information.
Okay.
And
sure.
If I'm going to vote on a particular issue, I want a compelling reason. Not because I don't want to vote on something without having asked the hard questions and gotten the thoughtful answers. So I think on this particular issue, you've provided a persuasive answer, and as has Mr. Church. So.
Okay, with that, we will entertain a motion.
I make a motion to terminate the legislative advocacy agreement with Joe A. Gonzalez and Son, and approve an agreement for services with David Church and Associates for the period ending June 30th, 2015, in the amount of $24,000 per year, and authorize the city manager to execute the necessary documents.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion?
Yes. Yeah, Jennifer, you're supposed to be head no.
It's supposed to be $18,000.
Yes, I wanted to clarify that amount, that it's a typo. In the staff report, the amount is correct. It's down to $1,500, but the correct amount is actually $18,000.
Okay.
With that correction?
With that correction, in the amount of $18,000 per year, and authorize the city manager to execute the necessary documents.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Church. That does conclude our council meeting this evening. But this evening when we close,
Mayor, we have successor agency.
I'm sorry, we have successor agency. Okay, but I'm...
We did.
Okay.
We did.
Normally I close and then we go into successor agency, but that's all
oh,
right.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Yeah, let me close the council meeting and then we'll go into the successor agency.
Sorry.
When we close our council meeting this evening, we're going to close in honor of the 19 firefighters from Prescott, Arizona, who lost their lives on Sunday fighting the wildfire in Arizona. This was a member, this was a crew called the Granite Mountain Hotshot Crew. There were 20 members on this crew. Only 19 were present. One member was assigned somewhere else temporarily and was not with it, the rest of the crew. Their ages ranged from 21 years old to 43 years old. These 19 men had been battling this wildfire, and they are, without a doubt, the elite firefighters in our country. And unfortunately, they got caught when the winds turned, and there was no place for them to turn. This is the greatest amount of loss of life for firefighters since 1933. And it was the deadliest day for the firefighters since September 11th. The hotshot crews are the people who actually run directly into the fires. And they are the ones who take the chainsaws and the shovels, and they try to fight the fire directly at hand. It is one of the most dangerous jobs in the world. This particular crew has a strong connection to Southern California and even to people in this chamber. Several of them were from California. And this crew, in 2009, when we, along with all of the other Foothill communities, were involved in fighting the station fire, this crew was a crew that came to fight this fire. And in particular, Mr. Steele's neighborhood. He lives in La Cañada, and this crew directly saved his neighborhood. This crew has many ties to our community. It is a tragedy beyond measure. These men have given their lives to protect other lives and property. And we will always remember them. And I would like to close by naming each and every one of the 19 men. And we will be closing in their honor. They will always remain in our hearts, and we will always be grateful for their work. Andrew Ashcloth, 29 years old. Robert Caldwell, 23. Travis Carter, 31. Dustin DeFore, 24. Christopher McKenzie, 30. Eric Marsh, 43. Grant McKee, 21. Sean Meisner, 26. Scott Norris, 28. Wade Parker, 22. John Persine, 24. Anthony Rose, 23. Jesse Steed, 36. Joe Thurston, 32. Travis Turnbyfill, 27. William Warnicky, 25. Clayton Whittend, 28. Kevin Wawiski, 21. And Garrick Zerpertine, 27. We will close in their memory, and let us remember the sacrifice that they have made in Arizona. This concludes the Monrovia City Council. Our next City Council meeting will be Tuesday, July 16th in these chambers. We will now adjourn the City Council meeting, and we will begin our successor agency meeting. And I will ask Ms. Atkins to take up the role, please.
Let's see.
Here.
Yeah, it's authority members, agency members. I don't know. Board members. Adams. Blackburn.
Here.
Spicer.
Here.
Vice Chairman Shevlin.
Here.
And Chairman Lutz.
Present. Consent calendar.
Move approval.
Second.
Any discussion? I know it's hard to get back into the swing. I understand. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Next on our agenda is public comment. Does anybody have anything that, do we have any speaker cards first? Does anybody like to speak to the successor agency this evening? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public comment and take up our administrative report, SAAR, maintenance and license agreement with Eagle Rock Brewery, and Jennifer McLean will give us this report.
Great. Well, good evening, Chairwoman Lutz and Councilor Successor Agency Board members. So tonight we will be considering the approval of a maintenance and license agreement for Eagle Rock Brewery of one of the successor agency owned units at Hamby Park. When you're considering this tonight, we are really just looking at this agreement, which is essentially a temporary right-of-way, but we're presenting you with some more information to give you a complete picture of what Eagle Rock is envisioning for the future of this site. It's important to do as we're going through this process with Department of Finance to get a really clear idea of what Eagle Rock Brewery would like to do there, but working within our restrictions of what we can legally do with the Department of Finance. So currently the city owns, maybe that will budge sometime. There we go. As you know, the city or the successor agency owns several properties within this former Station Square area. And in the red dotted lines are the areas that the successor agency currently owns. Within the yellow shaded portions are the Hamby Park units. And these were originally purchased back in 2008 to be utilized as part of the Station Square Transit Village. Since then, we've held onto those properties in anticipation of future development, but with the elimination of redevelopment, that has somewhat altered our ultimate vision for the site. We have been looking to the private market at this point to develop the site, but we have still not yet included what our vision is going to be. We haven't taken this concept to the successor agency yet in anticipation of what we'd like to include in our long-range management plan. So at this time, this is the Hamby Park unit. We own four of these, and the site at hand is 124-126 West Pomona. It's an adjoining unit, about 30,000 square feet. The agency or staff...
Oh, no, 3,000.
I'm sorry, 3,300 square feet. Agency staff has not been marketing this site. but we did receive a proposal from Eagle Rock Brewery. Thank you. Eagle Rock Brewery is currently, it has a location in Los Angeles, and we consider them to be a pioneer. They were the first to open a brewery in Los Angeles in 60 years, and we were quite excited when we received the proposal because we, quite honestly, we were flattered to see that they could see the potential of this future area. What their ultimate vision for the Hamby unit, it includes a cold storage, dry storage, a barrel room, and a tasting room. And they are also proposing to include tenant improvements as well. What we would ultimately suggest is recommending that they would lease it on an as-is condition, so they would have to assume these future ADA, HVAC, plumbing, and electricity upgrades. Part of the reason why we were so excited, and we've been working not just with Eagle Rock, but on other proposals as well, is that there seems to be quite a market for microbreweries within Los Angeles and Southern California. Locally, we see some economic development benefits. There's the opportunity for them to capitalize on the future Gold Line extension. We've also seen that there's a potential for it to create a potential destination business. There are places, if you were to go online right now and Googled LA breweries, you would see that there are actually these tours that are now going around to the different breweries within Los Angeles. And we would expect that Eagle Rock would be a part of that within Monrovia, since they're already a part of that in their current location.
It would be an additional sales tax revenue generator. These would actually be considered manufacturing jobs. And quite frankly, it's an emerging cluster. The number of breweries operating within the states continues to increase, and the number of jobs that we're seeing as a result is also increasing. So with that said, while there are many benefits to this, and while staff was quite excited to receive this proposal, the process is not easy. The first thing that we would need to do is, I'll take a step back. Eagle Rock would actually prefer to move quite more quickly than this agency can move. They would like to move in, or they would have liked to have moved in a couple of months ago, but with the process right now with the long-range management plan, the Department of Finance, having to go through the successor agencies, there are just a number of steps. So as one way to be attempt to be business friendly, to show good faith effort that we will work with them to try to get them in quickly, is to come up with this maintenance and license agreement. So if the successor agency were to grant them approval, the Eagle Rock would be able to move in immediately. And from there, we would then consider including that type of use in the long-range management plan. And at that time, the successor agency, again, would consider whether this is the type of use you would like to have at that location. And from there, it would have to be approved by the Department of Finance. So with the maintenance and license agreement, it's a temporary term for 6 months. And within that time frame, we're hoping that we would get Department of Finance approval if we were to move forward with the long-range management plan. And of course, there's a third step in this, which they would have to obtain a conditional use permit as well. So there are many different steps within this process, many different opportunities for the public to provide input. What staff is hoping with this maintenance license agreement is to simply give Eagle Rock the opportunity to move into that location. And again, for us to show good faith that we realize that we are limited in what we can do nowadays without redevelopment, but that we see the potential in this business and that we would like to help foster and be a part of this emerging trend. So with that, we do have Eagle Rock that is here, and they can answer more questions about who they are and why Monrovia, and then if that's okay, I'll pass it over to them. And yes, sir.
Before we move on to that, can you tell me the difference between the maintenance and license agreement instead of just a normal lease?
Yes.
What are we licensing?
Well, essentially,
I'll have Mr. Steele
take this.
What are we licensing?
Right now, we're licensing the right of entry to the building and dry storage in that facility until such time as you finish the long-range management plan, which would then allow, once it's approved, allow for a long-term lease.
Is this a legal distinction that we have to comply with?
It is. Well, okay. It's a legal distinction in that the license agreement that's before you right now is a temporary revocable right to use that property for a short period of time.
Okay.
A lease gives an actual property right.
Gives them some rights.
Right, and okay. we can't grant a lease until that plan is
until
done.
The state approves
right.
it.
Yeah.
Right.
So okay. as Jennifer's saying, it's a way to help out moving this along
sure.
while we're still in the midst of preparing the
Makes
plan.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Why don't we see if there are other questions of you or our council prior to having Eagle Rock speak?
Okay.
So, does anybody else have any questions for staff? Mr. Blackburn? Okay, then great. Eagle Rock, okay. Sorry. Just wanted to make sure we got all of that out of the way before we have you introduce yourself. Please come to the microphone and identify yourself for us, please.
Thank you, Jennifer. Good evening, members of the agency. I'm Jeremy Robb, and this is my wife, Ting Su, and we are co-owners of Eagle Rock Brewery. We're a family-owned company that has been in operations for 3.5 years now, and as Jennifer said, we were the first brand new microbrewery within the city limits of Los Angeles to open our doors in 60 years. And since that time, there has been about a dozen other breweries that have opened up in the city of LA, but also in the surrounding region. And it's sort of echoing a trend that's happening throughout the country right now, in that the microbrewing or craft brewing industry is really really enjoying a kind of a revitalization. And just to give you an example of the sort of growth that we're talking about in this niche market of our industry, after Prohibition, there was only about four breweries in the United States. And up until about the early 80s, there was less than two dozen in the United States. Last year, there was about 1,500 small breweries in the United States, and that was the first time since Prohibition that that number was over 1,500 breweries. This year, and one of the slides that Jennifer showed was a number that that the current number, there's now over 2,400 small breweries in the United States. So the growth rate is really pretty remarkable in this industry, and job creation and kind of engaging of our customer base is really what we're best at. So we see this opportunity to come into Monrovia as an opportunity to connect with a new customer base and educate the customers in the city of Monrovia, but also the surrounding region, and to be able to kind of create more of a sense of community, which is what we feel like we were able to do in Los Angeles.
Does anybody have any questions for our applicants?
More for Craig, I think. Okay. Can we trademark like Gem City Ale before this happens?
Is that a rhetorical question?
Oh, no, I'm serious.
I'd have to look into that and get back to you, Councilman.
Could you check on that?
Oh, I would.
Thank you.
I do have a couple questions for you. How many people do you employ at your facility currently, and what do you anticipate for the facility here?
So we currently employ seven employees, and four of those right now are full-time. Three of those are part-time. As I mentioned, we've been in business 3.5 years in operations. It took us about 2 years, by the way, to get through all the red tape of the city of L.A., so we've been in operations.
So you're feeling really good about us, right?
In the 3.5 years that we've been in operation, the first year, it was really just me and my wife and my dad, who are the owners of the company, doing pretty much everything that we could ourselves. And then after the first year, we hired our first employee. And then within that time period from the first to second year, we hired three more employees. And then this last year, we've just hired three more. So.
And how long do you anticipate, should we approve this tonight and you move in, before you actually open your doors and start your business running?
Well, I think that kind of depends on...
That's really dependent on us.
It really depends on the long term.
We have to come back to you once the management plan is completed and the Department of Finance...
So are we saying then that we can let them come into the facility, but they can't really start their business until the plan is approved?
The point of this agreement is to allow them to move... materials in for storage until the plan is approved. That's all that they're asking to do at this time. And then as soon as the plan is approved and you can move forward with a formal lease, then I would anticipate you'd be back here with the lease agreement, as well as Jennifer mentioned, the CUP that would need to be granted for the business itself.
So this would be just kind of preparation.
No, this is really limited to storage of dry goods. And maintenance, continuing maintenance of the facility while they're storing their goods there.
Okay.
I can give you just an overview of our vision for the site is, for the short term, being able to kind of relieve some of our growing pains in the sense of storing dry goods, storing, our empty kegs. We get probably on average about 100 kegs back from our distributor every week that are empty and waiting to be cleaned and then refilled and sent back out into the trade. So, those take up space, obviously, and also empty bottles that we get bulk glass, pallets that are about 6 feet tall, and storing those until the time that we need to label them and fill them and you know, ship them out. Mm-hmm. Sort of all of those elements are sort of components that we need some relief on right now, like in the shorter term, to be able to focus on continuing to grow in our current production facility. And then the longer term plan would be to you know, then be able to use that site down the road for, as Jennifer mentioned, cold storage, which we would have, you know, finished packaged beer in sort of a intermediate storage between our production facility in Los Angeles to our distributor in Carson, having a place to store large amounts of beer packaged. What that will enable us to do is right now we're basically manufacturing on demand, or, you know, just in time, as it's known. So our distributor will place an order with us, and we'll try to fill that order completely. But the logistical side of that in beer production is that we sort of have to line up beers that are almost ready to be packaged in tanks, and so it effectively slows us down without having a place to store beer intermediately. The other component would be a barrel room, which is a place to condition beer in wooden oak wooden barrels. Mm-hmm. And this is a method of producing beer that's a very traditional old method that's now kind of gaining popularity again. And so we would plan to then condition beer in those vessels and then have a public tasting room, ultimately, where people could come in and the barrels would be sort of a showcase, you know, really like similar to a winery. It's a really nice, attractive view from the tasting room, and then being able to sample some of the products on site as well.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Okay, we will entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt. Oh, yes, I'm reading the wrong page. I'm sorry.
I'll move approval.
We have a motion.
We do.
And we have a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. This passes. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you.
It's reading the wrong page.
Okay, that will conclude our successor agency agenda. We will now be continuing our closed session, and we will report the closed session from these chambers after we have concluded later on this evening. Thank you very much for attending, and we will see you on the 16th.